big meeting last night. Gave me lots to think about. I'll be talking with you guys about it before very long. Always decisions before the church. Today is the funeral of my dear friend Frank Shackley. And 10 o'clock this morning. Praying for Carolyn and all her family. It's been a hard year. And yet, we're in the book of Revelation. And we're remembering that Jesus is coming, as we said yesterday. And that he has the victory over all this stuff. We're going to sing at the name of Jesus. We're going to do it better this time. We did 2 days ago. This time I'm going to use a capo. It's a little easier to read these chords, the alternate chords. We're going to sing the first verse again, but now we'll sing then verses 5, 6, and 7, which we didn't sing a couple days ago. Excuse me. Oh, it's a hymn number 512. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess him, King of glory now. 'Tis the Father's pleasure we should call him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty Word. Your hearts enthrone him, there let him subdue all that is not holy, all that is not true. Crown him as your captain in temptation's hour. Let his will enfold you in his light and power. Christians, this Lord Jesus shall return again in his Father's glory with his angel train. For all wreaths of empire meet upon his brow, and our hearts confess him King of glory now. Then to Jesus, who the Prince of Light, to a world in darkness brought the gift of sight. Praise to God the Father in the Spirit's love. Praise we all together him who reigns above.
Revelation to John, chapter 1, verse 9, vision of the Son of Man. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamum and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. And on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze refined in a furnace. And his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, Fear not. I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, the things that you have seen, those that are, and those that are to take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches.
And so begins the strangeness of the revelation to St. John. This is where it starts to get weird. Already, first chapter. John says that he was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. The word testimony means in Greek is the martyrios, the martyrdom, but the literally the witness of Jesus. And the word of God and the testimony, the message that Jesus brought, those are the things that John stood with. And because of that, he is in exile on the island of Patmos, and he is in worship. When he says that he was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, doesn't necessarily mean that he was in a trance or some sort of ecstatic experience, but that he was worshiping, he was in the Word, and he was reflecting on God's Word, and now God gives to him this vision. And it's strange, like dreams, like visions may be, there are reflections of many things in these images. He hears the voice, first of all, behind him, a loud voice like a trumpet. So this is an announcement, and he turns around. The voice has said, write what you see. He doesn't see anything yet. He whips around and he sees the Lord. That this is not like the last chapter of the Gospel of John, where they're out fishing, you know, and Jesus is on the shore and he's making breakfast. He's got a fire going there, and he tells them, cast your net on the other side of the boat, and they're bringing all these fish, and John looks to Jesus on the shore and he says, it's the Lord. No, this is turning around and seeing Jesus, and he's unable to say, it's the Lord. He falls down like he's dead. He is so overwhelmed by the image of Jesus that he falls to the ground as if dead. It's like it knocked him unconscious, perhaps. It's not like the Transfiguration. On the Mountain of Transfiguration, Peter and James and John see Jesus transfigured before them, and it is a reflection of Jesus' glory in heaven, what Jesus will be like when he returns to his Father in heaven. But this is the full glory of the Son of God. As radiant as the sun, this imagery of this sword, in real life, that seems absurd, right? How does he speak and so on? You could try to go through that. But in visions, these are images stacked on images that give an impression to John of Jesus' power and his authority, the word from his mouth that is cutting, that cuts through all of the stuff of the world and brings the truth. The golden sash around his chest, the sign of royalty, and his hair being white, the sign of maturity and power and wisdom. His eyes like flames, the imagery of the one who purifies. The flame receives the offerings at the temple and the altar and burns them up and purifies God's people. And this flame purifies John and all of us. His voice like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword. His face is like the sun shining in full strength. And Jesus says, hey, don't be afraid. Why? You gotta be kidding me. Don't be afraid. He places his hand on John. John has collapsed to the ground. At the Transfiguration, it says that Peter and James and John bowed to the ground. They, you know, of their own will, they bow to the ground. But in this case, it's not just that he makes this decision to do obeisance. He drops like a rock. And Jesus, this powerful figure, how does he reach down and touch John? He's gotta bend down to the ground and do that and place his hand on him and say, "Don't be afraid." In light of all the things that he's about to show John, that he can say, "Fear not." How can John not be afraid? How can we not be afraid? You see the trajectory of the world, all these forces and these things going on. Just pick up a newspaper on any given day, a volcano over here, a tsunami over there, earthquakes, floods in Germany, floods in China, people dying of plague, wars, terrible crimes, awful things being committed. How can we not be afraid? We are not afraid because Jesus says, "I'm the first and the last. I'm the living one. I died, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and Hades." He says, "I have the power over all things. I died, and I am living. And so, therefore, you have nothing to fear." That's an important precursor then, because he says, "Write therefore the things that you have seen, those that are and those that are to take place after this. This vision that you will receive, write it down." And if John is to write it down, it's important for us to read it. It's important for us to listen to it, to face it, and to not be afraid. And the very first interpretation of all the signs that God gives in this book is at verse 20. "As for the mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." We'll talk a lot about those churches, but those stars, the angel of the church, the word is easier in Greek than in English, because it's just plainly, these are the messengers of the church, the angelos, the messengers. They're not literal stars, and they're not angels the way we picture them, with wings and fluttering around, secretly guarding the church. These are the messengers to the church. They represent the pastors or the teachers, those who bring the word to the church. And the lampstand, these seven lampstands, the light in that place. There are those who bring the message, and the congregation is the light in that place. Jesus is this overpowering radiance. But wherever his people are, they are the light in that place. And some are faithful and some are unfaithful. Some are faithful or unfaithful in different ways. But that's us. That's the congregation that you belong to, whatever it is. There's many people from different places who join us on this. Your congregation has its faults and its flaws. And the messenger, the angel of your congregation, has his or her faults and flaws. But we bring the word. The congregation radiates this word, bringing light into a community, into the area around it. We'll consider how God calls us to be faithful. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to us. Lord, thank you for receiving him again into heaven and into glory, great glory that we can scarcely imagine. Father, we pray, grant that we may reflect the radiance of Jesus, the power of his word, the victory over death that you have given to us to share. Grant that we also may be witnesses, martyrs, and angels, messengers from you. Lord, I pray for our gathering this morning as we remember Frank Shackley and the gifts you gave to us through him. You've received him to yourself, and he is in the presence of Jesus right now. Lord, grant that we also may be in Jesus' presence when we worship, just as he promised we would be. And that we may share our angelic message with one another, and that we may shine to lift up and enlighten the world in darkness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. You know all those little circles up there, all those faces? Yeah, it's just like, it's almost like sitting with the congregation out there.
Sort of.
Hey.